Sanjay, this piece is really fascinating and terrifying, I got to say. They're just, these cell phones haven't been around long enough, it seems like, to really have an accurate sense of whether or not they're safe.
That's the issue, is that, you know, there haven't been studies to conclusively show that they're dangerous, but there's not studies out there to show that they're conclusively safe either. The problem is the ubiquity of these, Anderson, and how much we're using them. Even some of the earlier studies, regular cell phone use would be defined as, you know, a couple of hours per week for 6 months. Who uses their cell phones like that? I mean, most people have it planted to their head many hours of the day and for many years to come. So
the whole idea that, you know, in the fine print of the owner manual and stuff, it says you're supposed to hold it, I don't know, 5/8 of an inch away from your head or something. No, who does that? I mean, I keep mine pressed up. My ear gets warm. I have it pressed against my head so much.
Yeah, I don't think most people read the little fine print there. But what I think what's even more impressive about that is that as much as, you know, you hear from the FCC saying, look, no precautionary measures are necessary whatsoever, the manufacturers themselves, Anderson, are saying, look, 5/8 of an inch away from your ear. I mean, that's impractical, but all away from your body in general. So not even in your front pocket, you know, next to your bone marrow, next to your reproductive organs. You know,
you're not even supposed to have it in your pocket?
Well, they say, you know, supposed to keep it 5/8 of an inch away from your body. So it's you know, I mean, if you had it in your pocket, it's probably right up against your skin. So it's, you know, you're supposed to put it in these holsters, again, which very few people use, or in a separate bag and carry it with you.
Yeah, I look like enough of a geek as it is. I'm not sure I need a holster, but after seeing this report, I'm going to get one of those earpieces and try to use that.
Yeah, well, I was going to ask you if you actually use one. You know, I use mine all the time. You know, when we travel overseas, I don't know if you've seen me with this in my ear. I've actually bring you one by your office, too. We're sending one to your office, so you're going to have one as well. Look, you know, it's one of these things, Anderson, and I don't want to sound like a conspiracy theorist or even, you know, histrionic about this, but it is a pretty easy thing to do, to use the earpiece. And again, manufacturer from the cell phones themselves recommend keeping it away from your a wired earpiece is a good way to do that. I've been using it for years now. Who knows what 20 years from now we're actually going to know about this?
Right.
But you know, if the results come back that it was a problem, this is pretty protective.
Well, there's also, at least in my thinking, when I thought about this, and in fact I was just talking about it in the office today when we were talking about your piece, is that I sort of assume, like, well, look, everyone uses cell phones. They must be tested and safe and stuff, but clearly, they just haven't been around long enough, and just because everybody is using them, it doesn't mean that everybody, you know, that there's not going to be some terrible news about these things down the road.
We find out things years down the road. Leaded gasoline, asbestos, even cigarettes. It takes time for some of that data to come back. And you saw how decidedly low-tech, I mean, the safety testing is. I mean, I was surprised. I thought it would be much more sophisticated. It's not. And Anderson, let me even tell you, I mean, I got my cell phone right here. You know, that number that you saw on the piece, 1.6, you know, is sort of the absorption rate.
Right.
If you're on your phone and you're having a bad signal and you're having a hard time hearing somebody, that means your phone is setting off even more radiation at that time, trying to get you a better signal. So that number is not constant. If you have a bad signal, if you're overseas and having a difficult time hearing somebody, you're actually getting more radiation at that time. So these numbers really pop up and down.
And what is it about the microwave radiation that could potentially cause problems?
That's a good question. I mean, you know, so ionizing radiation is one end of the spectrum. That's X-rays. Everyone agrees in large amount that can be a problem. Non-ionizing is more like a low-powered microwave oven. You know what a microwave oven can do at high powers? It can cook food. The question is, at low powers for long duration, could this be acting like a little microwave oven next to your head and causing tissue to heat up and possibly causing damage that way? We know for the first time this year from a study at the NIH that cell phones have an impact on the brain. It changes the way the brain metabolizes around the area of the cell phone. So there is an impact. The larger question is, what is that heating and that increased metabolism going to do in the long run? Could it lead to cancer? That's what a lot of people are trying to figure out.
I've actually gotten a rash at one point in my ear from my cell phone, from like the heat of it. I'm completely going to switch now based on what you're saying and your report. You also told me during the break that this Dr. Black treated the lawyer Johnny Cochran. And what did he tell you about why he thought Johnny Cochran got a brain tumor?
Well, I've been investigating this for some time, and it was a conversation with Dr. Black a few years ago. I asked Dr. Black about Johnny Cochran. I said, do you have any idea why he got a brain tumor? And he replied almost without hesitation and said, it was his cell phone usage. And I said, and I even said, Dr. Black, come on. I mean, there's been a lot of studies that show that that can't be true. There's no link. And he said, I'm convinced of it. I'm saying the science simply has not caught up. People who use their cell phones a lot, you tend to see it. And at that time, wealthier people, because they're the ones that had cell phones, people who had jobs that required them to be on the cell phones a lot, he's starting to see an uptick in brain tumors in that specific population of people. And like you, Anderson, it's frightening to sort of think about, but that's what he's starting to see as a very busy brain tumor surgeon.
From now, there's no doubt I'm going to change my behavior on this one. Dr. Sanjay Gupta, appreciate it. Thank you, Sanjay.
Thanks, Anderson.